I shall start. So introducing myself, I am Ayush Sumani from the Department of Maths and Computing. We'll present our paper titled Digital Staining of Mitochondria in Level 3 Live Cell Microscope. I think you all shall be hydrated and with lots of caffeine in the morning coffee, hopefully ready for our research presentation and find it informative and exciting. Before commencing, I would like to introduce my team and thank my team from multiple disciplines working together, contributing to the progress of the research work. So in today's life science, most cellular components, being transparent or colorless, cannot be examined under a transparent light microscopy. A subcellular structure with hundreds of mitochondria, thousands of vesicles and nucleus and other specimens usually creates a hugely cluttered image, thus making it challenging to extract specific information from the sea of data. Thus, staining molecules with different colors plays a vital role in simultaneously tracing distinct cell components. Hereby, the need of spatial fluorescent staining techniques of blood cells to label and extract information of mitochondria, vesicles, and other nanoscopic structure for medical study and development. I shall start with the very obvious question, why the need of digital staining? What are the benefits and how could it impact medical science? First, we need to understand the urge to develop a model to stain a bright field image into its fluorescent stained counterpart. Pathologists have found this efficient way of staining cells to study specific structure with high precision with advancement in microscopy imaging, previously beyond the scope of level 3 microscopy. But fluorescent staining, with its sole major advantage of studying nanoscopic structure with ease, had many disadvantages. This motivated us to train an efficient model to generate a digitally equivalent fluorescent image from their label counterparts with high accuracy. So covering a few benefits, apart from being economical solution, digital staining also reduces the dependency on high-skilled label personnel. It abstains from the time-consuming process of manual staining of cells, cumbersome to perform. The limited photon budgets is losing its charm for its phototoxicity and chemical perturbation to the system. It gives us an equivalent selective tracking of the cell specimen with ease. Avoiding fluorescent substance allows a long duration study of the cell for more exhaustive aspects of the application. So moving forward, this is a diagrammatic explanation of how the neural network architecture with many layers trying to translate the bright field image through a black box algorithm. Here, using conditional generative adversarial network can provide digitally stained counterparts, further segmented for subcellular structure labeling and cell tracking. The unstained embryonic heart tissue imaging A is passed through the generator network to generate a stained counterpart B on the right side. The discriminator network C is then fed with the fake and the real counterpart to output probability distribution for the detection of the accuracy. It is an iterative min-max game of optimizing both the architecture's laws function to get efficient performing generative model. So you might be wondering, this is a unit architecture for a generative network that has been widely successful in image segmentation and translation tasks. How is our work creating an impact on the traditionally followed state-of-the-art approach? Let me explain. Visually, the state of the art looks good. We are able to identify the structure, but how confident are we in terms of statistics and interpretation? While in certain application fields, this may play a secondary role, but in high-risk domains like healthcare, it is crucial to build trust in a model and to be able to understand its behavior. Often seeing is believing, but sometimes we should do something more than seeing. So I performed the SSI metric analysis and found the performance wasn't that happy. We can see on the figure that the state of the art has a asymmetry which could be improved. Contradictory, we have witnessed wonderful accuracy of the cGAN in various data sets and vast applications like digit recognition, image derailing, convolutional face generation, etc. If cGAN has predominantly been successful in image transfer learning, there must be something we are missing in the learning curve of the model. The reported SSI metric accuracy from the papers like colorectal tumor detection, CBCT image denoise reduction, overexposure recovery has used cGAN clearly suggests a significant gap in how the network can perform, meaning we have an application-specific problem here in nanoscopic imaging. So it is our work to fulfill the gap between the potential of the architecture versus what we can achieve on this application, an approach to improve the visualization of the mitochondria in better metric accuracy. There are two tasks in hand. One, either we modify the architecture or modify what it learns. It is apparently easy to tweak the system to take what the model is being able to emphasize to learn by changing its loss function that adapts well to the application. Among all the potential challenges we tackled, a missing piece of the puzzle is the model's pipeline wasting so much of its effort in the irrelevant information of the background, leading to a slower convergence. And the magic is in its background operation. Basically, we need a mechanism that can integrate this background separation information with our conventional state-of-the-art deep learning architecture. Hence, we have redefined our loss function to be more foreground sensitive. That is, the fluorescently labeled mitochondria we see here in the green and suppress the background noise expressed by red areas to an extent, yet keeping it differentiable and context intact in the entire image space. The proposed loss function has provided us with the ability to tweak the system's learning and make it more robust for improving the model's performance and reliability. On the top is the conventional state-of-the-art loss map visualization, making the foreground learning inaccurate and convergence cumbersome. Below is the proposed loss function using multiple thresholding followed by normalization of the image space based on the three sigma rule to achieve a weighted matrix able to differentiate between the foreground without eliminating the background context entirely. This not only helped in faster convergence on the TDS adversarial min-max loss game, but also outperform the state-of-the-art approach. We can see that the component of feature of interest was able to be differentiated from the foreground, yet creating a faster convergence. The variant approach result in column 3 and 4 witnessed significant improvement both in visualization and quartile-wise analysis compared to the traditional L1 approach on the right. We can see that the features are more clear, vibrant, and has a better accuracy compared to the state-of-the-art approach. If you're interested in the mathematical formulation, it would be nice to look at the paper where I have discussed the formulas and what the notations signifies elaborately. So the comparative study of the proposed TN weighted loss map compared the state-of-the-art L1 discriminator loss trained on 5,936 cell image pairs showcased that the proposed method has outperformed in all the four common generator transformer loss variant for image translation tasks, with a large margin of mean SSI accuracy for the test set of 848 images. Thank you.